hear the last talk. This is a great combination. And I'm going to be talking about how transposable elements have played a role in the evolution of mammalian pregnancy. So a lot of the innovations involved in mammalian pregnancy seem to have evolved stepwise, concurrent with the evolution of mammals. So all mammals, including the egg-laying mammals, had internal provisioning for the embryo as well as the placenta. Then, therians, which are the marsupials and the placental mammals, evolved live birth, even though parity, coincided with the loss of the eggshell and yolk. And the mutherian mammals, which are the placental mammals, evolved decidual cells, which mediate a lot of other innovations, such as maternal recognition of pregnancy, fetal immunotolerance, and invasive placenta. So concurrent with all these phenotypic changes, we wanted to know if there are also gene expression changes. So I have 27 different organisms from both mammals of all kinds and some outgroups that we have RNA sequencing data from. And I use a parsimony-based ancestral transcriptome reconstruction method that I'm happy to talk about later to find that there that hundreds of genes change expression during the evolution of mammalian pregnancy. And this is just a subset of the organisms on the tree, but the numbers are from the full data set. So, for example, from the ancestor of therians to the ancestor of eutherians, so marsupials and placental mammals to just placental mammals, which is about 55 million years, 835 genes gained expression, and 185 genes lost expression. And so, from this, I was curious, how do these novel gene expression patterns evolve? So I decided to look at cis regulatory regions. I was looking to try to answer this question. So first, we had to identify all the cis regulatory regions within the decidual cell type. And we did this in human decidual cells. And we found, used H3K4 triboglycationship-seq to identify promoters, H3K27 acetylationship-seq to identify enhancers, and DNA synferase-seq to define open chromatin regions. Once we had these regions, we then looked within them to kind of look at composition. And we found that a lot of these regulatory elements contain transposable elements, including a lot of what we call ancient mammalian transposable elements, which are the mammalian, therian, eutherian specific. However, looking at these pie charts, you might think that they don't deviate that much from expected genome-wide transposable element content. But when we break it down a little further into transposable element families, we find that 393 transposable element families are actually more enriched within these regulatory elements than we would expect by chance when compared to genomic abundances. So from here, the obvious question is, well, did these transposable elements contribute to the evolution of gene regulatory networks? And if so, how? So this idea that transposable elements can play a role in the evolution of gene regulatory networks is not necessarily a new one. It's been kind of thrown around since Robert McClintock started studying TEs in corn. And so the way this would work in a non-TE evolution system is you have a gene, somewhere in the upstream of that gene, you have a sequence of nucleotides. This nucleotide sequence can acquire a mutation, which allows it to bind a transcription factor that's expressed in the cell type, which then could drive this novel expression of the downstream gene. Now, transposable elements are pieces of DNA that can jump into the genome and rapidly copy themselves throughout. So if that original transposable element had a transcription factor binding site, it can jump into the genome with that binding site and rapidly copy that binding site all the way throughout the genome, leading to the evolution of a novel gene regulatory network. And now up until this point, I've talked a lot about transposable elements in extant regulatory regions. And a lot of other labs have shown that transposable elements can function as enhancer elements, and I'm currently working and gathering data on that within our cell type. So the question I'm going to talk about in this talk is, did these TEs integrate with regulatory ability, or did they evolve as regulatory function later on? So is the ability to function as a regulatory element something that it came in with that first element integrated into the genome, or is it something that acquired through mutation as the genome itself evolved? And so to do this, I first found the consensus sequence for all 90 of the 393 enriched transposable elements that I've found. And I use consensus instead of actual ancestral reconstruction due to the limitation that the outgroup for having a TE is not having a TE, and it's very hard to root on nothing. So consensus sequence is the best approximation we have right now. So I take the consensus sequences, I get them built into a luciferase reporter vector. These are circular pieces of DNA that have the luciferase gene, which along with its substrate will cause the cells in which these vectors are in to glow if it's expressed. It also has a consensus sequence as well as a minimal promoter. I then take these plasmids and I transfect them into endometrial stromal fibroblasts, or put them in the cells, These are the precursors to the residual stromal cells that I've been talking about all the way through this. I can then give half of these cell populations progesterone and cyclic AMP, which are the pregnancy signaling factors, and kind of trick them into thinking they're pregnant, and they'll differentiate into the residual stromal cells. So now I have two cell types that I can test for the ability of these transposable elements to drive luciferase expression. This also lets me look for progesterone responsiveness, which is important when I'm looking at elements that might be important in the evolution of pregnancy. So this is what my data looks like. It's a lot. Each one of these boxes represents the mean of six replicates. This first row across the top in both parts of here are endometrial stromal fibroblasts, and the second row are the decidual stromal cells, so the progesterone exposed ones. This very first column is my negative control, which is a luciferase vector with no transposable element construct within it. And the second column is my positive control, unknown progesterone responsive enhancer in decidual cells. And then the brighter the red, such as these, means the stronger the enhancer function. And the brighter the blue, the stronger the repressor function, with white indicating no function. So what you can hopefully see, unless you're colorblind, I guess, is that most of these transposable elements do have some sort of function. Interestingly, though, we naively entered this experiment thinking we have three classes, enhancer, no function, and repressor, and that they'd be of roughly equal sizes. But what we found is that 20 of the elements seem to have enhancer function, 14 seem to have no function, and 51 are repressors, which was kind of surprising. So the first question we asked was, is there just something strange about this cell line? So I decided to test all these constructs again in the HepG2 liver cancer cell line. And when I do that, we find that 55 of our elements are still repressors. So it seems like it isn't something inherent to the cell, but maybe something that has to do with my constructs or the plasmid. So then the question became, well, is it active or passive repression? So active being that these elements themselves are bringing in things to either repress the element or repress expression. Passive being sequence independent, just the act of having something in these constructs is kind of hindering the expression of the luciferase gene. And to test this, I decided to use the HDAC1/2 inhibitor, trikostatin A. So I gave all of my stromal cells and decidual cells trikostatin A, and when I do this, we see a relief of repression. So it's a little more evident down here, but we see a lot more of these red squares than we did before. And this supports the current model for transposable element silencing, actually, which looks something like this, where you have this crab zinc finger, which targets the transposable element in the genome. It brings in this CAP1 protein, which then mediates other repression complexes to come in, including DNA methyltransferase and this NERD HDAC repression complex, which is what I likely inhibited when I added this HDAC inhibitor, trikostatin A. So we wanted to kind of confirm that this is what was happening. So we then asked, well, what if we put these constructs in a non-mammal cell type with minimal zinc fingers, so the chicken cells? So chickens should never have seen a mammal-specific or younger transposable element, which is what the vast majority of my elements are. They also only have 8 zinc fingers in comparison to the hundreds that humans have. So this is really minimizing any sort of targeted repression that this would lead to. When I do that, even more than the trikostatin A, we see a major relief of repression across the board. A lot of things that were repressors previously have now become enhancers within our chicken cell type. So again, this is still really supporting this model. And the next thing we asked was, well, what happens if we knock down CAP1 using siRNAs? And the reason we're going with CAP1 and not the Krebs zinc finger proteins is that there are lots, hundreds of Krebs zinc finger proteins, so I can't knock down all of them at once. There's also no small molecule inhibitor that I can find, but if you know of one, please let me know. But we do have siRNAs to knock down the CAP1 protein. So when we did this, I only have a subset of the TEs completed right now, but they range across ages and classes. We see that the knockdown, which is this last row down here, isn't significantly different from the original cell type that we tested, which suggests to us that CAP1 is not playing a role in the repression of constructs here, which is interesting because while it's known that CAP1 is important for the silencing of transposable elements in gamete and stem cell lines, it's still really controversial its role in somatic tissues like my residual stromal cells. So our current hypothesis is that Krebs zinc fingers might actually be mediating this TE silencing in our tissues, but it's not through CAP1. And we're unsure currently what this protein might be that's actually mediating this repression response. We're still designing experiments to test it. I just got this data on the trip out to Evolution. So fresh data. So hopefully we'll have more soon. But just a quick summary of everything I told you so far is that lots of genes have gained expression during the evolution of mammalian pregnancy. Transposable elements may have played this role, but testing them is difficult because the ancestral consensus to Eve might be being silenced. And the silencing seems to be CAP1 independent, which is, might be in conflict with current thoughts about how T's are being regulated. And so with that, I'll thank my lab, all of our collaborators, and my funding.